Hi, these are the top 20 films of 1987. When I say top, I mean my personal favourite films. 1987 was a great year for cinema, so there's going to be loads of films I've left off, so please do include your favourite films down below. Anyway, let's get on with the list. In at number 20, Near Dark. Narrowly beating out the other big vampire film of 1987, The Lost Boys. Catherine Bigelow's directorial debut about a group of nomadic vampires travelling through the West is grim, violent, and a lot of fun. The family made up of mostly actors from James Cameron's Aliens are brilliant, in particular Bill Paxton as the arsehole vampire Severin.
I hate when they ain't been shaved.
In at number 19, No Way Out. A really solid 80s Cold War thriller with one of the greatest twists of all time. Kevin Costner and Sean Young are both very good, but as usual, if a film's got Gene Hackman in it, he'll steal the show.
You've been out of town. And you have a pleasant flush.
I got some sun.
Oh, how nice. And with whom did you get this sun?
What?
In at number 18, Empire of the Sun. Steven Spielberg brings some Hollywood gloss to this World War II coming-of-age war film. Christian Bale, at the age of 13, is already a wonderful actor, playing a boy struggling to get by in a Japanese World War II prison camp. My favourite scene in the film has Bale running through the streets of Shanghai begging for help because he's British.
Help me! Help me, I'm British!
In at number 17, The Witches of Eastwick. A really fun romantic comedy about Satan. Cher, Michelle Pfeiffer, and Susan Sarandon are all brilliant as a group of witches, but of course it's Jack Nicholson who steals the show as the devil.
Hi.
In at number 16, The Last Emperor. While not all of it entirely works, Bertolucci's biopic is one of the best-looking films of the 1980s. Vittorio Storaro's cinematography, especially in The Forbidden City, is remarkable, giving this film about the last emperor of China a true epic quality. In at number 15, Lethal Weapon, one of the best action films of the decade. Richard Donner's glossy direction, Shane Black's snappy script, Michael Kamen's saxophone-heavy score, and two brilliant central performances make this one hell of a ride.
Gun! Gun!
Raj, meet your new partner.
Oh, I'm too old for this shit.
In at number 14, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. My personal favourite John Hughes film, because it's not about privileged teenage tossers. Steve Martin and John Candy couldn't be funnier in this road movie about a mismatched pair trying to get home for Thanksgiving.
You're going the wrong way!
What? Fuck.
Why?
In at number 13, City on Fire, a film Quentin Tarantino borrowed heavily from for his directorial debut Reservoir Dogs. The similarities are striking, especially in the final act, but while Dogs takes place in one location and is heavy on character and realistic dialogue, this film is a bombastic Hong Kong action thriller that's quite the ride. In at number 12, Goodbye Children. Another coming-of-age film set in World War II, this one very upsetting. Before any of the real tragedy occurs, this film set in a boarding school in France during World War II is already a tough watch. Lots of bullying and ribbing before the Nazis even turn up. A hard watch. In at number 11, Radio Days. Woody Allen's love letter to the radio shows of his youth. It's really a series of sketches set around New York in the late 30s and early 40s. It's nostalgic and very funny.
Get regular with Relax. Start every day the Relax way. Your system will feel so great you'll want.
Like this. Relax, relax.
What should I be thinking inside?
Think laxative.
Think soothing relief.
Please, I'll give her a motivation. Laxative, darling, you crave one.
Here are some other notable releases of 1987. Bizarrely, the highest-grossing film of the year was the Leonard Nimoy-directed Three Men and a Baby. Less successful was the Dolph Lundgren-led He-Man Masters of the Universe movie, which for whatever reason I watched a lot as a child. Joe Dante's Inner Space was imaginative and very funny. Peter Jackson made his directorial debut with the revolting Bad Taste. For action movie lovers, there was a lot to like. Timothy Dalton became the fourth James Bond in the underrated The Living Daylights. It's a bit odd though, watching Bond join the Mujahideen.
I'm sorry we missed the concert. We had some trouble at the airport. Can't imagine why.
Buddy cop movie Stakeout was a lot of fun.
Touchstone Pictures zeigt Richard Dreyfuss und Emilio Estevez in einem John Batham Film.
Hast du safer sex praktiziert?
Wahrscheinlich nicht. Die Nacht hat viele Augen. Wer sagt, dass ein wenig Gefahr nicht auch eine Menge Spaß machen kann?
The Running Man, starring Arnold Schwarzenegger, was good, silly, violent nonsense.
But I hope you leave enough room for my fist, because I'm going to ram it into your stomach and break your goddamn spine! Ah!
And the best shootout of the year appeared in A Better Tomorrow 2. I'm sorry, The Untouchables. It's just that it's John Woo. For horror fans, there was a lot to like. There was the best Nightmare on Elm Street sequel, Dream Warriors, and the first Hellraiser, which was brilliantly twisted. But as a little boy, the film that scared me the most was Mannequin, starring Kim Cattrall. A romantic comedy about a shop dummy that comes to life. Another film I watched a lot as a kid for some reason. The scene where she's nearly put in a wood chipper type thing really used to freak me out. Other romantic films of the year included Moonstruck, starring a 41-year-old Cher and a 23-year-old Nicolas Cage. They both look like they're in their 30s. I can't tell if she looks great for her age or if he looks terrible for his. Dirty Dancing was a lot of fun, showing just how well Swayze could move. And Glenn Close loved Michael Douglas so much, she cooked him a rabbit in Fatal Attraction. Speaking of Douglas, he also won the Best Actor Oscar for his performance as Gordon Gekko in Oliver Stone's Wall Street. He's very good in it, but I kinda wish Robin Williams had won for his tour de force performance in Good Morning Vietnam.
Good Morning Vietnam!
The beguiling Babette's Feast won Best Foreign Feature at the Oscars, also winning an Oscar for Best Makeup, Harry and the Hendersons. Not winning any Oscars, however, was Jaws 4 The Revenge. And Superman 4, The Quest for Peace, where somehow Superman rebuilds the Great Wall of China with his eyes. Right, back to my list. In at number 10, Wings of Desire. Berlin is one of the greatest cities on Earth, and this film about angels wandering around it really does the city justice. Wim Wenders' movie features stunning black and white cinematography as we follow Bruno Ganz's angel, who's desperate to be alive. Much like Powell and Pressburger's A Matter of Life and Death, the afterlife here is depicted without colour, showing it as literally lifeless and somewhat depressing. Ganz is perfect at showing his urges to touch, feel and taste. He falls in love with a circus performer and decides to enter the world of the living. The film is full of beautiful little touches and is also quite odd, even featuring Columbo's own Peter Falk playing himself. It's a truly beautiful film that captures what it means to be alive and what it meant to be alive in 1980s Berlin. In at number 9, Robocop. This super-violent science fiction satire is pure Verhoeven, a film about a cop who is gunned down and then put back together as a cyborg to get his revenge, has no right to be this good. It deals with corporate power, a big subject in the 1980s, and depressingly it hasn't lost any of its relevance. Peter Weir plays the robotic policeman to perfection, while Ronnie Cox is brilliant as the asshole villain.
I used to call the old man funny names. Iron Butt. Boner. Once I even called him asshole.
Or in the edited for TV version.
Once I even called him airhead.
And as usual, Miguel Ferreira manages to steal every scene he's in. The violence is pushed to such an extreme that the film itself is making a comment on violence in cinema. The squibs have never been bettered. Paul Verhoeven is a mad genius, and RoboCop is one of his very best works. In a number 8, Broadcast News. This James L. Brooks romantic drama has one of the best ensemble casts of the year. At the centre of the film is a love triangle between three news journalists. There is the super-focused Jane, played with great intensity by Holly Hunter, Albert Brooks as Arto, an intelligent but nervous and uncharismatic hard worker, and finally there is Tom, played by William Hurt, a good-looking man with not much knowledge of the world, but one who knows how to spin a story. Joining them is an astonishing supporting cast, including Joan Cusack, Lois Childs, and Jack Nicholson. Brooks knows how to make films about people and about relationships. He also manages to make them funny. This is a great film, one of Brooks' best, and is a great look at the news and the constant battle between making it informative or simply just entertainment. In a number 7, The Princess Bride. Peter Falk amazingly makes a second appearance on this list, this time as a man reading his sick grandson a story. I'm still not entirely sold on this grandpa reading bit, but it does add a uniqueness to the film, and thanks to Falk and Wonder Years' Fred Savage, this section is still moving. The fantasy half, or in this case kind of three quarters, sweeps you off your feet. Robin Wright stars as Buttercup, a farm girl who is forced to marry the ghastly Prince Humperdinck. Before the marriage, she is kidnapped by a band of outlaws made up of brilliant characters. Wallace Shawn as their self-proclaimed Sicilian mastermind leader, the charming Andre the Giant as a giant, and stealing the show is Mandy Patinkin as Inigo Montoya, a sword master with vengeance on his mind.
My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
Chasing after them is the dread pirate Roberts, played with brilliant charm by Cary Elwes. The adventure, the romance, and the humour is all pulled off perfectly by Rob Reiner, who was really on a roll in the 1980s. The supporting cast is magnificent, including Spinal Tap member Christopher Guest, Mel Smith as an assistant in a torture chamber.
Where am I?
The pit of despair. Don't even think.
Don't even think about trying to escape.
Peter Cook as a priest.
Marriage.
And Billy Crystal and Carol Kane as two old medical wizards.
Bye bye, boys.
Have fun storming the castle.
Think it'll work?
It'll take a miracle.
Bye bye.
It's an impossible film not to like and a hard film not to love. In a number 6, Predator. John McTiernan starts his run of outstanding films, most of which had no right to be. Whether it be a cop in a building fighting terrorists single-handedly, or this sci-fi action macho fest about an alien on a hunting holiday. Arnold Schwarzenegger stars as Dutch, a leader of a military group on a mission in the jungle. His team is made up of macho men, including wrestler Jesse Ventura and stew enthusiast Carl Weathers.
Whoa, there's still plenty of meat on that bone. Now you take this home, throw it in a pot, add some broth, a potato. Baby, you got a stew going.
Their initial mission is a success, but things start to go from bad to worse as they begin being targeted by an alien with camouflage technology. The action is top-notch, as you would expect from McTiernan. Yeah.
Stick around.
And the sci-fi elements are done spectacularly. From the eerie sound of the Predator, to its outfit, to the remarkable practical effects of Stan Winston. The film has a wonderful gloss to it, a word I keep using, will it? It is the 80s. And this is helped by the location photography and Alan Silvestri's iconic score. There have been many sequels, but none have matched the original. In a number 5, Raising Arizona. The Coens prove their comedy credentials with this, their second film. As dark as Blood Simple was, this is as funny. A kinetic, quirky, hugely entertaining romantic comedy. Nicolas Cage plays a convenience store robber who falls in love with the policewoman who keeps taking his mugshot, played by Holly Hunter. They can't have children, and when a local businessman has quintuplets, they decide to take one. This puts in motion a wild ride full of energy involving bounty hunters and even an early great performance from John Goodman as a prison escapee. Barry Sonnenfeld's cinematography has wonderful energy, and the camera is constantly on the move. Cartwell Burwell's score suits this perfectly. Cage and Hunter are superb as the leads, but it's the Coens themselves who stand out as the stars. Their offbeat comedy immediately shines.
Hey, he's blow up in a funny shape, said all.
Well, no, unless round is funny.
We'll take these two.
They would go on to make many more great comedies, but their first is possibly their best. An immensely fun ride. In a number 4, Evil Dead 2. Speaking of fun, this revolting sequel improves on the original in almost every way. Sam Raimi returns and basically remakes the first one, and with a bigger budget, he adds a larger scale and a heavy dose of comedy. Bruce Campbell returns as Ash, and once again, he and his girlfriend foolishly unleash demons that torment them in a cabin in the woods. The gore level is up, and so is the energy. It's as close to a live-action cartoon as you could possibly want to watch. Kinetic, mad, imaginative, hilarious, and still creepy. Sam Raimi knew how to make a groovy movie.
Groovy.
In a number 3, The Emperor's Naked Army Marches On. One of the best documentaries of the 1980s. Hara's film follows one hell of a real character. Kenzo Okazaki was a veteran of World War II. He never forgave the Emperor for sending him and his friends to die in Papua New Guinea. The film plays out as a sort of real-life investigation and revenge film. Okazaki had already served prison terms for murdering a man, and for attempting to shoot the Emperor with pachinko balls. Now he's on the trail to find out why two people in his unit were killed, 2 weeks after the war had ended. We follow him interviewing, well, really interrogating men who were there. It's clear everyone is hiding something, and to get the truth, he more than once physically attacks them and repeatedly threatens them with violence. It's a remarkable thing to watch. His methods are atrocious, but they do lead to results. The truth is revealed, and more horrible revelations come out. The film also ends in a remarkably shocking fashion, in a way that totally suits Okazaki. An astonishing documentary about a remarkable man. In a number 2, Full Metal Jacket. Stanley Kubrick's penultimate movie. It's tragic that he struggled to get his movies made. It had been 7 years since The Shining, but finally he was able to get funding for this Vietnam War picture. Like many Kubrick films, it has two distinct halves. The first is probably my favourite, where we follow new recruits going through training. It shows the brainwashing and dehumanising of these men. R. Lee Emery is outstanding as the drill instructor. He's funny, scary, and infuriating in equal measure. A man whose job it is to bully, and a man who's excellent at his job.
Do you suck dicks?
Sir, no, sir!
Are you a Peter Pupper?
Sir, no, sir!
I'll bet you're the kind of guy that would fuck a person in the ass and not even have the goddamn common courtesy to give him a reach around.
The main character of this first half is probably Private Pyle, played wonderfully by Vincent D'Onofrio. He's excellent as an overweight man who's bullied by the drill sergeant and by his fellow Marines, all building to a terrifying conclusion. The second half takes place in Vietnam, though it was remarkably all filmed in the UK. The resistible Matthew Modine plays Private Joker. He's kind of irritating and is therefore perfectly cast. We follow him as he covers the war for the military press and then him in combat. The climax is edge-of-your-seat stuff and is a great metaphor for the war as a whole. Kubrick had dealt with war before, but here manages to have a new angle on it. He was one of the greatest filmmakers of all time, and it was a tragedy that we'd have to wait 12 years for his next and final film. And in a number one, with Null and I. My favourite comedy of the 1980s. This bleak film about two alcoholic actors in the 1960s is filled with incredibly quotable dialogue.
The thermostats, what have you done to them?
I haven't touched them.
Then why has my head gone numb?
Written and directed by Bruce Robinson, this is a semi-autobiographical story. I is played by Paul McGann. When we first meet him, he is suffering with a comedown off speed.
My thumbs have gone weird.
He lives in Camden with a fellow unemployed actor, Withnell, played superbly by Richard E. Grant in a career best performance.
We want the finest wines available to humanity. We want them here and we want them now.
There's not much story, really. Their drinking is out of control, so they decide to have a break in the countryside and it all goes horribly wrong.
We've gone on holiday by mistake. We're in this cottage here. Are you the farmer?
Stop saying that, Withnell! Of course he's the fucking farmer!
The two central performances are great, and equally good is Richard Griffiths as Withnell's predatory uncle, Monty. He's wonderfully tragic, intimidating, and remarkably funny. There's many other great performances in the film. It had a tiny budget of £1.1 million. Half of the money was put up by ex-Beatle George Harrison, who was a hero of British cinema with his production company Handmade Films that allowed directors to make the films they wanted to.
Well, man, what's his name?
What about him?
I didn't even give him a call.
What for?
Ask him about his house.
You want me to call what's his name and ask him about his house?
Why not?
All right, what's his number?
I have no idea, I've never met him.
Well, neither have I. What the fuck are you talking about?
It's a murky-looking film, but all of this works in the story's favour. It's a depressing world these bums inhabit. The film is British through and through, in its humour and in its tone.
I can never touch meat until it's cooked. As a youth, I used to weep in butcher shops.
Withnell is one of the great tragic film characters, hilarious and doomed.
I'll show the lot of you! I'm gonna be a star!
Withnell and I is a totally unique picture, one of the best comedies of all time, and my personal favourite film of 1987.
I must have some booze. I demand to have some booze!
Right, so counting down my top 20. In a number 20, Near Dark. In a number 19, No Way Out. In a number 18, Empire of the Sun. In a number 17, The Witches of Eastwick. In a number 16, The Last Emperor. In a number 15, Lethal Weapon. In a number 14, Planes, Trains and Automobiles. In a number 13, City on Fire. In a number 12, Goodbye Children. In a number 11, Radio Days. In a number 10, Wings of Desire. In a number 9, Robocop. In a number 8, Broadcast News. In a number 7, The Princess Bride. In a number 6, Predator. In a number 5, Raising Arizona. In a number 4, Evil Dead 2. In a number 3, The Emperor's Naked Army Marches On. In a number 2, Full Metal Jacket. And in a number 1, Withnell and I. Well, those are my top 20 films of 1987. There's probably loads I've missed off. So what are your top 10 films, 20 films, 30, whatever, of 1987? Cheers.